December 10, 1963. 60-year-old Italian scientist slowly walks to the podium of the University of Oslo auditorium, accompanied by his son and four other colleagues. He has just won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for his work on polymers, first and only Italian ever to do so. But the bold steps that once led him to pioneering studies are now made stiff by the progression of Parkinson's disease. His fellow laureate, Carl Ziegler, looks at him with awe, while his wife, Rosita Beati, keeps smiling at him from the audience. As a literature scholar, she had coined some of the key terms of his research, drawing concepts from grammar to name the new knowledge that her husband was discovering. So knowledge and words, the chemist and the writer, the glory of achievement and the fragility of disease. As he walked across that stage in Oslo, Giulio Natta also displayed the paradox of his invention, plastic. Powerful new chemical structure allowing malleability, versatility, resistance, and innumerable applications, yet also a material that depends so much on our understanding, on our capacity to assign it the right name or culture. We always hear negative things about plastic, or rather its misuse or abuse. But can we conceive of a world without it? Just imagine electronics, packaging, healthcare, or appliances without plastics, and you see the impact that Giulio Natta's discovery had on our daily lives since that day in March 1954, when he first jotted in his journal the phrase, "Fatto il polipropilene, polypropylene is done." Giulio Natta was born in the Ligurian city of Imperia in 1903 and studied chemical engineering at the Polytechnic University of Milan. After graduating in 1924, he began a long academic career which led him from his professorships in Pavia, Rome, and Turin back to his alma mater in Milan, where he taught from 1938 to the end of his life. His research mainly revolved around X-rays, catalysts, and the structure of organic polymers. After World War II, the large chemical company Montecatini was intrigued by his scholarly work, funding his research on catalysts and offering him laboratories to experiment with polymers from petroleum. In parallel with Carl Ziegler's studies on polymerization, Natta's work on catalysts led him to produce a new polymer in 1954, which he called isotactic polypropylene because of the order of its molecules. Natta's technique to polymerize propylene led him to the creation of a new material endowed with the properties of toughness, flexibility, lightweight, and heat resistance, which Montecatini would produce on an industrial scale starting in 1957. What the company marketed as Moplen from 1959 is what we now simply call plastic. The new material fueled the growth of Montecatini, which in the 1950s became not just a hub of chemical innovation, but also a successful brand for the large-scale commerce of plastic toys, food containers, gaskets, and home appliances. This innovation, which triggered the golden age of Italian chemistry, had its roots in the 1930s, when in a time of autarky, the fascist regime supported research on new materials. Until then, Montecatini, which had started in 1888 as a copper mine in Tuscany, mainly produced pyrite and sulfuric acid for fertilizers. Starting from the 1930s, Montecatini pioneered the manufacture of nylon, a polymer fabric obtained from petroleum, and also built the scientific and entrepreneurial capital which would lead to the breakthrough of plastic in the 1950s. The fertile soil of Natta's innovation also includes his relationship with his wife, who borrowed the terms to describe his newly found structure from grammar, paralleling the disposition of molecules with syntactic coordination, parataxis, and subordination, hypotaxis. Her passion for literature nurtured Natta's imaginative mind, offering him a more nuanced approach to his chemical research. The inextricable ties between writing as an endless combination of elements and chemistry as a dynamic language of transformation found expression in those same years in the work of chemist, Auschwitz survivor, and author Primo Levi, from his Holocaust memoir, Se questo è un uomo, If This Is a Man, to his autobiographic collection of short stories, Il Sistema Periodico, overlapping his life with the elements of the periodic table. Plastic came as a similar synthesis of scientific and imaginative vision. Natta's creative attitude toward petroleum mirrors a typically Italian obsession to see matter imaginatively from within, as I discussed in the episode which I dedicated to steel producer Armando Cimolai, and also in my interview with bioengineer Fiorenzo Omenetto, who found in silk a building block for the creation of holograms and films. In another way, Natta saw in isotactic polypropylene not just an ordered disposition of molecules, but also a plastic nature, capable of giving his new material endless dynamism and innumerable combinations. His mold, from the original meaning of the Greek verb plasein, was then both a functional matrix and a flexible language, enabling the limitless molding of objects, words, ideas, and concepts. Natta's scientific breakthrough led to unparalleled and unthinkable developments. From the original isotactic polypropylene, which is still used in water bottles, packaging, and yogurt cups, many varieties of plastic were created. Polyethylene, which is used in trash bags, bottles, and containers, PVC, which is used in wrapping films, PET for soda bottles and medical containers, and polystyrene for tools. Against the backdrop of industrial consumerism, plastic fed a new disposable mentality and opened up a new era of production, communication, and storage. As a new material not found in nature, plastic appeared in its early years as a new gold, the piece which God forgot in creation, and a tool allowing a new dominion over reality. It didn't take long, however, for this new light and malleable matter to become a strange symbol of omnipotence and fragility. At its launch in 1959, with a famous TV campaign by comedian Gino Bramieri, Moplen represented a new marvel, granting modern life lightness and joy. Riding the wave of its success, Montecatini opened a new production center in Brindisi, but financial mismanagement of the new factory led the company to eventually sell its shares to the electric group Edison in 1966. The new brand Montedison, born of the merger between Montecatini and Edison, was subsidized by the state on two occasions, in response to the oil crisis of 1973, and in the late 1980s, as the new majority stakeholder, agribusiness tycoon Raul Gardini, faced financial struggles following the acquisition. At a personal level, Natta's discovery of plastic also coincided with the drama of his Parkinson's disease, which led to a gradual physical decline until his death in 1979. Despite his scientific impact, however, his legacy was spoiled by the paradox of his invention, which proved fundamental in many sectors of human life, including medicine, as we saw during COVID, but which also created islands of trash on land, in the ocean, and even in space. Natta's studies took a new form in the work of his son, Giuseppe, chemical engineer, waste recycling entrepreneur, and founder of the Cassinazza Farm, a 20-year project dedicated to environmental education, which re-established soil fertility and biodiversity in a vast countryside area near Pavia. Now, I want to take you back to that podium in Oslo in 1963. Can we imagine a world without plastic? Before you answer, you must tell me in all sincerity if you would go back to a world without the internet or without phones. So, like many pieces of human innovation, plastic embodies a paradox of new control and unexpected fragility, of advancement and misuse. If you take the example of Alfred Nobel, whose effigy appeared on the medal that Natta received, you might see my point. His invention, dynamite, was a tool for the building of tunnels, canals, and infrastructures, yet it became an instrument of war and destruction. The same dialectics of benefits and problems can apply to any new technology, from iPhones to artificial intelligence. The issue then is not to get rid of innovations, but rather to learn how to use them properly, turning their power into a vehicle of ongoing dignity and culture, as it happened with the Nobel Prize. Faced with our current crisis, then, a new imagination of plastic is needed, or rather, a new integral understanding of it, including both a scientific and cultural dimension. Moving beyond the instinctive and ingrained paradigm of immediate consumption requires, in fact, not just a recycling mindset aimed at maintaining matter in a dynamic flow without stalling it as waste, but also a creative vision of primary and secondary uses, so parataxis and hypotaxis, as well as of new contexts, new applications, and new ideas. Maintaining the plasticity of plastic, both in terms of functionality and aesthetics, requires constant education and the audacity of new words and reflections, as it was at the beginning. The story of Natta's groundbreaking innovation thus begs a fundamental ethical question. When we strike gold, how can we learn to treat it as a gift and not as a tool of exploitation? When we discover something, how can we turn our pride into renewed imagination? When we reach a goal, how can we see achievement not as memory, but as starting point? In this sense, the story of plastic is a paradigm of the role that culture must play in framing, defining, and sustaining the meaning, scope, and truth of an innovation. While Natta's scientific work launched a new creative age for Italian chemistry, grounding Italy's current leadership in the pharmaceutical sector, his life is a continuous testament to the fact that when a breakthrough happens, words are needed to accompany it. A culture is needed to keep it fresh, and a critical judgment is needed to evaluate its applications from that stage in Oslo to today. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this presentation, I invite you to subscribe to this YouTube channel or to the webpage www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for additional materials about the show. Thanks again. Arrivederci e alla prossima.